Thank you very much. It's a pleasure being here, and I'm glad now that we're drilling down from the epidemiology to really focusing on the people. So we all know that there's large concentrated epidemics among men who have sex with men in regard to HIV and STIs, but this slide really is the thesis of the presentation. It's multifactorial. So we have biological factors. We know anal intercourse increases susceptibility. But we also have to pay attention to the issue of role versatility, particularly for transmission of some of the STIs, including HIV. There's a big focus on individual number of partners, but not enough of a focus on social sexual networks. So there are some groups that engage in assertive mixing. So, for example, in the United States, there's a disproportionate epidemic among black men who have sex with men, not because they have more partners than white men who have sex with men, for example, but there's a higher concentration of infection within a community where people are more likely to have partners from the same race and ethnic group. But there also are sexualized venues. So certainly, historically, there are bathhouses, but now social media create new opportunities for concentration of infection and people meeting higher risk, higher infection burden partners. But we also can't ignore the social and structural factors. So the pervasive role of homophobia globally is very important, leading to early developmental stress, syndemics of depression, lack of self-efficacy, which increase risk. And certainly in many parts of the world, continued criminalization and discrimination leads to avoidant healthcare behaviors. So just to put a finer point, we heard earlier from several speakers, Johnny included, that MSM is an epidemiologic term. So the cartoon on one side says, no, we're not twins. So people may have their stereotypic views of what a gay man looks like. But on the other side of the slide, my colleagues at the Hump Safar Trust in Mumbai have this cosmology of the different subcultures of MSM in urban India. And some of these are situational roles. Some of these are related to occupations. But it's a different way of looking at the universe. Also, it's not really who you think you are, but what you do when we're talking about STDs. So another study that we did in Mumbai actually did respondent-driven sampling. We took seeds where we selected men who were married to women who had sex with men and men who were not married to women who had sex with men. And when we did the RDS, we actually found the adjusted rates for HIV were identical. Syphilis may have been higher among the unmarried men, but rates of gonorrhea and chlamydia were quite comparable. So that it really, again, is who you're having sex with, not who you think you are. The role versatility is extremely important. And what makes it complex when we're thinking about STDs is the issue that different STDs are transmitted different ways. So HIV for MSM, we're mainly focused on penile rectal sex. But certainly we'll be hearing in this conference questions about the role of oral sex, and particularly with regard to gonorrhea transmission. We also know that we're going to focus on STIs because of bacterial STIs. We'll focus on condoms, but we're not going to necessarily be able to say the same benefit from condoms protecting against some of the viral STIs. We focus a lot on PrEP and the treatment as prevention error, but really this issue of men who have sex with men making seroadaptive choices has gone on well before the era of highly effective therapy and PrEP. So these data from a national survey in Australia published in 2011 show a whole range, you know, from green being the safer practices to red being clearly practices that are unprotected and at high risk for STIs. And you can see a variety of different permutations that people may select, but certainly a substantial number of people were not using condoms prior to the era of PrEP, which was not approved by the first normative body till 2012. So clearly, we have to think of the behaviors in a larger context than only a pre- and post-PrEP era. Work done by Ian Spicknall and colleagues from the CDC looking at the National Survey of Family Growth looked among men who reported being sexually active with another man in the prior 6 months. And you can see that role versatility is really quite common among men who have sex with men. And this is really one of the factors that can potentiate transmission and we need to pay attention to in terms of our messaging. another area where we'll hear more about from Ian McGowan later today, but the whole role of anal intercourse itself, a very carefully done study by Colleen Kelly in Atlanta. She took 41 HIV uninfected men who have sex with men who engaged in condomless receptive anal intercourse with a monogamous HIV uninfected partner, and 21 individuals who never engaged in receptive anal intercourse, and found that there was upregulation of a variety of immunologic markers. So, in other words, just the sheer act of the trauma of sex and or the exposure to semen can upregulate inflammatory markers. And also, the rectal microflora were not protective, that there was increased prevalence of Prevotella, which can be associated with mucosal injury. So the mucosa substrate may be affected directly just by the practice itself. So if you add into the mix then an agent like HIV, which hones in on immunologic cells in the gut mucosa, it's a perfect storm for enhanced transmission. We know from multiple studies, these are data from a California study, Kyle Bernstein, who's here, and Patella from New York have very similar data about bacterial STIs and the prediction of HIV incidence. These are data from the U.S. There's similar data from Europe, but there's increasing attention to the data in Africa, again showing the potential for disproportionate epidemics among men who have sex with men in multiple African countries. So these data from Nigeria show very high rates of bacterial STIs and similar data from South Africa. So this again creates the risk for spread of the synergistic epidemics. We have had this focus on in the public media about PrEP being demonized, but these are data from our own clinic in Boston at Fenway Health, looking over the past decade. And what you can see in the lavender line is the rate of increasing bacterial STIs. So we've had an eightfold increase in bacterial STIs. And you can see in red the percentage of people who developed the bacterial STI who are on PrEP. And it has gone up substantially, but still the largest bar is the green bar, and those are HIV uninfected MSM who are not on PrEP, who you could argue would benefit from PrEP because they're at high risk for HIV. So we have to think about how to optimize the use of preventive technologies and giving consistent messaging. When we talk about what potentiates STI risk, there are multiple different snapshots, and it's not one size fits all. So certainly meeting partners online, there are multiple studies that suggest that plays a role. Anonymous sex may play a role as well. But you may also find that people who are meeting partners online have high risk for other bacterial STIs without these concomitant factors. One of the common features, though, particularly at those populations at highest risk for HIV, is the use of e-technologies. And we really have to spend a lot of time in the internet space using apps to really both reach people with education and access to services, because this is where the future is. This isn't to say that there aren't other places that people meet partners online, but here you can see data from Africa where you can see high prevalence of STIs and high prevalence of meeting partners online. And when you put the two together, people who were likely to meet partners online in Lesotho and in Swaziland, they were more scared to go out in public, worried about being gossiped about, so that there's more secretiveness, and they had a higher rate of HIV. So clearly, we have to up our game in terms of our outreach to MSM globally in the internet, because that is where people are meeting partners, and some of the people meeting partners in these settings are among the highest risk individuals. We still have physical venues where we can do interventions. We did a study in New England in a bathhouse, the largest bathhouse in the region, and we found very high prevalence of asymptomatic HIV, viral hepatitis C, syphilis, and gonorrhea and chlamydia. We also asked the individuals what do they think their risk was, and we found that the majority of men who were engaging in condomless oral sex and condomless anal sex thought that they weren't at particularly high risk for HIV. So clearly, even in this venue, educating people about their risk is going to continue to be an important issue. This whole issue of group sex is a challenging one. A recent study conducted in Amsterdam found that people who engage in condomless sex were less likely to were actually more likely to be diagnosed with gonorrhea, but it didn't persist in a multivariable model. And there was more condom use, but they still had a tendency towards increased gonorrhea. So it suggests that messaging to people about using condoms in specific settings may be important, because these individuals may be frequent flyers. So they may use condoms more in general, but it may be with study partners where they may be having their risk of acquiring the STI. Mental health issues, again, because of syndemic conditions, high prevalence of depression, high prevalence of substance use, and we're going to hear talk about chemsex shortly. And we have to think about what are the reasons for this. And certainly internalized stigma, internalized homophobia can be a big factor that leads to the high prevalence of these behavioral health challenges. And this, again, is not something that is just unique to the Northern Hemisphere. This study conducted by Susan Solomon, Steph Baral, and Lesotho, they looked at 527 MSM, and they tested them for HIV and syphilis, and they also did depression screening, and they found that individuals who were more depressed, were more likely to test positive for syphilis and for HIV or be diagnosed with any STI. So clearly, addressing the behavioral health issues is an important part of STI control. And last major theme, homophobia does impede addressing HIV-STI. Anticipated violence or threats certainly leads to lack of health-seeking behaviors. Insensitive healthcare workers also leads to lack of seeking healthcare. There are interventions. There's a website that we have, lgbthealtheducation.org, that I commend you to, that has taped webinars. And there's really no excuse in the current age for providers not to be culturally aware and be able to provide sensitive care to sexual and gender minority populations. So in conclusion, the MSM-STI burden is multifactorial. The drivers include biology, patterns of behavior, networks, and efficient venues to meet partners, internalized stigma because of societal homophobia. But in this era, STI rates may continue to increase unless we address societal discrimination, make the healthcare systems more responsive, and enhance community education. That I'd like to thank some of my colleagues who provided insights and slides, and thank you for your attention.